will the roller coaster be ready on time?
Flamingo Land theme park and zoo is due to open for the 2001 season. The nearest case of foot and mouth may be 40 or so miles away, but the crisis is affecting everyday life at the park. For one thing, one of the park's new arrivals is getting lonely, so head keeper Ruth Wesley is taking her to meet some distant cousins.
Abby, our baby camel, she was born 6 weeks ago. It was her mother Shirley's first calf, and she just rejected it. She didn't know what to do with it. If it had been a cow, something a lot tamer, we could have probably put the baby to the udder, got it suckling, and everything would have been all right.
That's nice.
But we weren't able to do that. She showed no interest in the baby whatsoever, and we had to make the decision to hand rear it. It isn't a decision we like to make. If a parent will rear a baby animal, that's how we want it to be. But it wasn't going to happen. We'd have lost the baby. She's now on three feeds a day. She's eating solids, and we take her out for walks.
Hello. Hello, Penny. That's Penny.
Ideally, we would have liked to have got a companion for her, but we haven't been able to bring any animals into the park. So that's the next step, is to get a companion for her and hopefully integrate her with the rest of the camels eventually.
Well, we've brought Abby down to show the Guanacos, because they're all of the camelid family, and we'd really like to get a friend of some sort for her, because we can't put her back in with the other camels yet. And we wondered, because I've got a tame one out there called Penny, if we could possibly get them together. So each day I like to bring them down, but it would be nice if we could just even let her run in with them for half an hour and see what they're like. But we don't, it's only an experiment. It's because she hasn't got a friend, basically. If she had a friend, it would be a lot different, but she hasn't. So that's why we come down and introduce her to the Guanacos, which are almost cousins.
Penny! Penny! That was nice, wasn't it?
Nearly.
Marketing director Melanie Wood is busy trying to drum up publicity for the park.
About 2 or 3 weeks ago, I sent through an invitation to yourself and Estelle for the opening of the park. We're doing a launch of the new attractions. I wondered if you received that. And I'm just ringing to see if either of you will be attending. I'll probably make contact with somebody at Scarborough Evening News. Hopefully they'll be able to pass any details on to you. Okay. Thanks, Adam. Bye-bye.
Melanie, can you explain what you're doing this morning?
This morning, as part of my job as marketing director, I'm contacting all the regional press to invite them along to our opening day on April the 1st, which involves the launch of our two new attractions, Little Monsters Den of Mischief and Professor Bubbles. So that's what I'm doing this morning. They got an invitation about 2 weeks ago, and I'm just following that up, A, to see if they received it, and B, to see if they'll be attending.
Much interest so far?
We've done it on two levels. We've done a daytime invite only, and we've done a complete weekend invite. The weekend invitation went very well. We have about 9 regional press attending, which is great. The day one, we haven't had a very good response yet, hence my calls, and fingers crossed by the end of today we'll have some better results. Every year we think, oh, we've got however many weeks over the winter, but every year it just seems to get less and less time. And the panic, the level of panic gets heightened every year. If you were to walk out there now, I can imagine that there's 80% of the workforce absolutely pulling the hair out, but that's good, because that's how it should be.
In fact, it's Melanie's 25-year-old brother, Gordon Gibb, the park's general manager, who's tearing his hair out. All is not well with the new ride, Mischief Mansion.
Last night was the first indication I got from anyone that we weren't on schedule.
What?
You said we're back on track?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we all said, but yeah.
I was speaking to John Martin last night. Yeah. I was telling him we're going to be a laughing stock on Saturday afternoon if this isn't going. We've got every member of the press nationally that we could invite has been invited.
Yeah.
About three quarters of them will be here. So not only will Flamingo Land look silly, but WGH will as well. Mm. Richard, morning.
Good morning.
First time you've seen the system?
Yes, it is. Yeah.
What do you think?
A lot to do. We'll see.
We had a big shock last night. We were told we were 3 days behind schedule over here. This is with regard to the track system, not the the artistry work and the theming work, which incidentally is going very well. It's the track system itself that's caused us some concern. 3 days will mean that, in a nutshell, this ride will not open on time.
In the zoo, it's moving day. The foot and mouth crisis delayed contractors working on new enclosures, but Woody the Brazilian tapir can finally be allowed outside for the first time in 3 months. Dogging the bullet seems to have been solved, and it's time for some important safety checks.
We're doing two tests here. The first is to check what forces are put onto the passenger during a run. That's the amount of G-force, the same as you'd expect from an RAF pilot that they go through or the space people go through. And we're just proving that it's, or measuring it to check that it's not too high for people to withstand. The second thing we're doing, and it's a slightly more onerous test, is that we're measuring the vibrations that are actually coming through the chassis work into the car so that the structural engineers can develop a test to find out what amount of fatigue there will be in the device. And that will tell them if it will crack in 20 years, 30 years, or in the worst case, within a short time. If you have too high a G-force, the first thing you see is bloodshot eyes. Of course, no one wants anybody to go from any theme park without with going away with anything that's wrong with them. And even though that in itself is not serious, it's the first sign of possible brain damage or anything of this nature. So we have to measure it and keep it within set limits. The trouble is that most of the data that we've got comes from very fit people, people who do it for the space program or for RAF pilots. And you hear of figures of 10G, 12G being put onto these people under test. But of course, they're very young, they're very fit, they're trained for it, they've got the right G suits. What we've got here are the average passenger comes on the air for a day out, bit of fun, doesn't want to go home with anything wrong at all. So we have to make sure that we've got a level that's right for them. She just tops 5G,
yeah.
Which is perfectly acceptable.
Yeah.
That's quite a good trace. It's almost impossible to say what are safe limits on a roller coaster in so many words, because it depends on the amount of time that people are subjected to that figure.
It's not that much of a possibility.
Of a rough idea, 5 or 6G seems to be an acceptable figure. Any more than that, we start ringing alarm bells.
Over at the zoo, managers want to make sure that keepers look the part on opening day.
The other thing is, if anybody wants any uniform, can you just write down what you want and let me know, because I'll have to put one big order in.
Oh, right. Yeah, but remember, we're going to a new colour.
We're not.
What do you mean we're going to a new colour?
Right, so a new look colour.
You haven't mentioned this to me.
Well, no, it's under debate at the moment.
But... Well, they can debate it.
I can't afford an entire new set of uniforms.
No,
well, we can start with bits and pieces, can't we?
So we're green with a brown patch.
What colour?
It's cargoes.
They are looking for more of a desert.
Just so you've got your uniform already, because that's what you always
wear. It's not down to me. It was when we were in Hanover, we saw them and they looked very impressive.
What colour were they?
We want to get away from this greeny look.
But we've just painted everything green.
Yeah, but what colour are they?
Purple. Well,
Born.
They're going for a more brownie look.
Oh, God.
Well, this is going down like a...
Zookeepers' uniforms are the last thing on Gordon's mind. He's still worried the new ride won't be ready in time and is having an emergency site meeting.
We want it finished anyway, regardless of ladies and gentlemen of the press. We've got fee-paying public, which are arguably more important. I mean, OK, it's going to portray a poor impression of Flamingo Land, you know, saying last night that's going to reflect on you guys as well, which we don't want. But worse than that, Joe Public, who we're here for, is going to receive a poor service. So regardless of anything else, we want the rider.
Right.
But it is a VIP day, and there's a lot of ladies and gentlemen in the press
I think
as well.
In all fairness, I think we will be running on Friday night for you. So, I mean, I don't really think we'll go beyond that time.
Phew.
I think I'll have a ride.
John Martin explains his company is also installing the new timecar system at the Jorvik Viking Centre in York.
When do they open?
They have a big publicity opening on the 6th of April, but the real hard opening is on the 7th of April.
Well, I hope you're not reprioritising them above us.
Well, I've got to work you on together.
They get
the only two.
They buy one track system.
I've also got Urbis. I've also got another two contracts
every,
as well.
Once every 10 years, they buy a track system. We potentially are buying one every year. You've got to remember that. But our VIP day's on Sunday.
Yeah.
Theirs is next, what will that be? Sixth will be the next Thursday?
Yeah. No, you will have your ride for Friday night,
right.
And then you'll be able to get all the people onto on a Saturday, and then on Sunday you obviously do what you do with press and television and all that kind
okay.
of stuff.
Okay, smashing.
Okay.
Right.
I'll see you later in the day.
Okay, I'll let you catch up with the guys and speak to you later.
What shall we go in the meantime?
Okay. Morning, John.
Good morning.
Are you well rested? Well rested.
There you are. Finished on time. How's about that?
Easy, eh?
No problem. There you go. I told him it wasn't a problem. Do you want to go in one?
I'd love to go in one.
Superb. I think we need more twists and turns, don't we?
This should trigger. What is it about males?
Yeah.
Regardless of education, class or anything else, we all laugh at a fart.
Yeah.
Extremely happy. That's turned into a success story. I felt we were losing that last night. Well, the honest response is we were losing that battle last night. There was fairly fundamental problems with the track system. That's been rectified. They've pulled the goods out of the bag a little bit closer to the wire than I would have hoped. But as we speak, we've probably got in the region of another 12 hours polishing time for that.
There's a final briefing for zoo staff before the public are allowed onto the park.
Right, the next discussion, it's on the top of all our minds, the impact of foot and mouth on the zoo. We all know what's happening. Bird walk wise is going to be open. The bird walk's open. The primates are on view. The sea lion show's open. And I'm fastened behind fences with my little tractor, never to be seen again. But that's the way we've done it. The public are going to have no contact with hoofstock at all.
It's been decided it was, risk wise, it was better to open this smaller part because then we've only got two people actually coming in contact with paddock animals throughout the whole zoo, and it's definitely the safest way to do it. So all in all, in theory, by opening part of the zoo, we've made the worst section a lot safer. We're still probably going to move some of the children's farm animals even further out of harm's way, but it's a lot easier to disinfect just a few people than hundreds, and this is what's been decided.
We're going to have to be just so vigilant about it all, and if you do see anybody abusing anything, or behind those perimeter fences,
this feeling at night, shining bright like a city. You are all that I want. I'm nothing without you, baby.
Gordon has has brought his managers together for a last-minute team briefing.
All right, folks, sorry about the cloak and dagger stuff. I just didn't want all and sundry to know that we were having an update meeting, all management in one room at one time. Might mean for people losing their focus a little bit, if you know what I mean. Anyway, the reason for, I know we're all very busy, but the reason for meeting up is just to have a bit of an interim report. We've got about 7-8 hours left. I want to know briefly where we're up to. Melanie, plans for the opening day?
Unfortunately, in the last hour or two, a couple of people have cancelled for one reason or another, which obviously I have to speak to you about. Changes the accommodation side of things. No, everything's fine.
Just one thing I'd like to spend a couple of minutes on before I let you all go. We may face a possible backlash through opening in terms of the foot and mouth crisis. I just wanted to talk you through the company policy decision behind that. The information that's coming out from central government and the ministry is confusing, to say the least. It's contradictory. We're disappointed with the lack of support that we've had. We've made an internal decision to open. We're in an unaffected area, as you know. We don't feel we'll be compromising the region's agriculture by opening at all. Our decision making's got to finish somewhere, and that point is the top gate. We'll have disinfection. This feeling at night, shining bright like a city. You are all that I want. I'm nothing without you, baby.
Saturday morning and the park is open. Members of the press and their families, invited by Melanie, are the first to try out the attractions.
I think that was dead scary. It's funny as well. I think I want to go in it again because they're good.
What about you?
Too scared, I'm not going again.
Do we need our speakers? Our little mics?
Yeah, and my caps as well.
Back at the Plaza Bar, the cast of the Professor Bubbles Dream Machine are preparing for their first public performance. But over at the Bullet, disaster has struck.
It's a horrendous blow, but it's actually a different fault. We had a fault, which we spoke about earlier in the week, which was we actually resolved. This fault is the generator set. Isn't recovering enough power to actually let the second drive kick in. So it's a totally different fault that we'll investigate and hopefully resolve fairly quickly.
Sunday morning, and it's the official opening of the new Little Monsters attraction.
A place of fun, mystery, and who knows what. Inside
from my point of view, the opening official launch of the new attractions perhaps could have gone a little bit better. Not all everybody who replied positively to my invite have turned up, which is a bit disappointing, as you can imagine. I'd expected in the region of 150 people, probably. We'll be lucky if we get 90. It's not bad, don't get me wrong, but I did expect better.
But brother Gordon seems to have had more success in getting publicity for the park. A story he gave to a freelance journalist has made the front page of a Sunday newspaper, and a television news crew has arrived to follow up the story.
The headline of the article was, you know, sensationalist. If people go to the time and trouble of reading the what's actually been said from Flamingo Land, it's not too much of a concern. But if people just read the headline and move on, then they're going to get the wrong impression quite soon. So this is a good opportunity for us to kind of set the record straight, as you said earlier.
You must have been quite shocked when you saw it.
Very much so.
But Gordon admits the story is basically true. The foot and mouth crisis is affecting meat supplies to the zoo, and it's been decided that animals like these wild boar could be fed to the Siberian tigers if supplies run out.
I'd have to be honest and say that had the headline been different, getting a front page off a major national is very beneficial to the operation. Yeah, I wouldn't be telling the truth if I said otherwise.
But over at the Bullet, disaster has struck again.
The fault we had yesterday was intermittent. It resolved, or we thought we'd resolved the problem. It ran all day yesterday, almost trouble-free. But unfortunately today, the fault intensified and it hasn't run at all. We continue to try and try and try to operate the device, but I honestly believe that it won't be operational today.
This weekend, I haven't had today's figures finalised yet, but it's not a tremendously busy day by any means. There's a lot of factors for that, but I'd have to say that it's not a particularly bad thing that we're not crammed to the rafters with people. It's been a great exercise for blowing away the cobwebs, though. In terms of getting the operation ready for peak season, we're ahead of the game. A week prior to normal opening, and we've already got some visitor numbers under the belt. But more importantly, the park's up and running and the new attractions have been launched. It's hard to be specific how much the business is worth. I mean, we could tot up the individual price of each particular bits of equipment we've got. We could value all the bricks and mortar out there. We could value the collection of animals that we have.
I think everybody would sell at the right price, but the price that I would put on Flamingo Land is too high for anybody to consider, because the value to me is more personal than financial. If I was to say, yeah, I would sell, give me £200 million, no one would entertain me. But that suits me, because unless it was something ridiculous, then it's not for sale, because there's too many memories, there's too much history here for me to sell.
But to me, how much is it worth? I don't think there's enough tea in China that could buy it.